I would now like to introduce our first speaker, Kit Hinrichs. Kit studied at Art Center College of Design in Los Angeles, California. By the way, I consider him a personal friend. I don't know if he considers me a personal friend. He served as a principal in several design offices in New York and San Francisco before spending 23 years as a partner of Pentagram, the international consultancy. In 2009, he opened an independent design firm in San Francisco called Studio Hinrichs. I'm not sure how he came up with that name. Hinrichs' design experience incorporates a wide variety of projects, including identity design, corporate communications, promotion, packaging, editorial and exhibition design. He's a recipient of the prestigious AIGA Medal in recognition of his exceptional achievements in the design field. And his work is included in the permanent collections of such prestigious institutions as the Museum of Modern Art in New York, the San Francisco Museum of Modern Art, and the Library of Congress. He is the co-author of, author of five books, including Typewise, Long May She Wave, and the Pentagram Papers. Kit is going to speak to us on the subject of patriotism, protest, and propaganda, the vacillating lives of America's icons. He examines American symbols, and particularly the American flag, for their visual strength and graphic form, together with their intrinsic cultural and emotional value. We will be privileged to view a very small part of his collection of Stars and Stripes memorabilia that began in about 1960 and has grown over to 5,000 items. And that's the number that was given to me. I suggest that it's a lot more than 5,000 items. Kit will share with us the history, myths, legends of such American icons as Uncle Sam, Lady Liberty, the American Eagle, the Shield, and how those symbols have influenced our cultural identity. And with that, I give you a great patriotic American and great graphic designer, Kit Hinrichs.
And after such a rousing introduction, he's still my friend. So that's glad to see that. I don't want this to be a lecture today. I hope that we're just kind of sharing things among friends who have the same kind of passions of collecting interesting visual materials and have a certain historical background to them. And if I can bring any information to that, I would be happy to. And we'll have a little Q&A at the end of this so we get a chance to talk about some things you may have seen or want to know more about. You notice that in addition to being a graphic designer, which is really kind of contemporary pamphleteer, I guess, is what we do, but also an American flag obsessionist. I mean, at some point, and I'm sure that there are many obsessionists in this audience as well, people who have this passion for things that just kind of, we could call it addiction, but that's against the law, so we're gonna have an obsession, we'll be okay. I'm gonna share with you a little bit of how I kind of got into this thing. So I'm going to start with the collection itself. And the collection is very, very broad. I think that I could probably talk about different areas that all of you have interest in. And all of a sudden, you'll find, gee, there's something that I collect that you also collect. It's just such a broad thing. But the origins of the collection actually begin with the only family heirloom I have, which is a flag sewn by my great aunt, great-great-great-aunt, Ida Peppercorn, in 1865, just at the end of the Civil War. And so this I used to bring out, show it in kindergarten at show and tell. And in the 60s, we framed it up, and it became the kind of icon cornerstone of the collection itself. But you can see the variety of things that I collect. It is not limited to ephemera or only American flags, but it's obviously political things. It is all kinds of propaganda of any kind. Anything that has the American flag in it or American objects in it. Now, I'm going to just give you a little quick look at some of the things that are actually in the collection, and then we'll go into some of the ephemera pieces themselves. Some of these things are just so damn magical. I mean, this is an actual centennial piece where 1776, 1876, all done in stars, and just really wonderful stuff. Here is a piece done by the Japanese. Japanese or Chinese, this is one of those things where it goes into multiple areas. It is the history of the American flag all done on one particular embroidered piece. It's pretty magical. I also collect weather vanes as well. So this doughboy that's in there is just knocks me out. I have never seen another one like it, so I don't know if it's a one of a kind, but it seems to be. And you'll notice on some of the stars there, of course, that they have a few bullet holes in them because they used to be on the tops of barns in the Midwest, and they, of course, got shot at because Saturday night, what else do you do? Of course, the shield is one of the other things that you'll find very commonly throughout Americana. This is actually done either from a carnival, because it's electrified, has light bulbs all the way around it, and it's about 4 foot square. And so it's a very interesting piece. It just kind of hangs outside of various institutions. But I also collect this vast range of things that you just don't think of everywhere. And spoons are one of those things where they're either in the bowl or it's inscribed in some way, or it's enamel or cloisonnade. So it's a very interesting kind of collection of items in this way. And of course, gambling of all kinds is there. So poker chips, and these are probably about 150 years old. They're clay and they break relatively easily, but they're an interesting little selection of things. And for those who collect anything with American flags on it, you can't count the number of stars and know it's exactly from that particular period, because we've been a very practical people, and if we manufacture things, if we think there's a couple of more star estates coming in, we'll just add a few stars ahead of time and let you know, you know. So, or if it doesn't have enough amount of room, we just don't use all those stars. So it's an interesting combination. All kinds of toys as well in what I put together. Great Stevens graphs, which are out there, and those are very common within all kinds of political things and have been for 100 years. And of course, we always have to have packaging, and if we've got whiskey in it, even better. So this was a wonderful lithographic piece from turn of the century. Folk art is also something that I find in there. So here's a piece that is done by a French immigrant who was living in the US, but was celebrating Lindsay crossing the Pacific, but there were also French going the other way. So he put the two flags together, put a couple of the pilots who was on it, and if you can see in just looking at it, where it up says Lady Lindy up above, that's a front view of the Spirit of St. Louis. So it's a very interesting piece just in itself. And it's about 5 feet large. It's a good-sized, interesting piece. Of course, women's compacts have always found their way in there in different combinations of flags. And I also contend... It's also contemporary things. I don't limit it to Civil War, to the Second World War. These are out there, and I thought, how can I pass those by? Those are just too damn good. And most of you at this point, you're a very educated audience, know that the cancellation mark on flags was on mailing was originally American flag. And so now it's oftentimes been just brought down to the wavy lines, but it originally was a full flag. But I also collect other things in this Dave Matthews Band guitar, and all signed by the members of it. So I also collect autographs in the process. And of course, toy soldiers. I have about 1,500 toy soldiers. These are about 6 or 7 foot high, 7 inches high. Sorry about that. I do have a tendency to exaggerate. So, and these are the models that were used for painting the rest of the line, so they would have these as a something to work against, so they had some consistent model. embroidery, of course, in the 30s, 20s and 30s. You had wonderful things in women's magazines you needed to send away for special patterns, or you could take them right out of the magazine itself. And, of course, jewelry of all kinds. If it's got a flag on it, I've probably collected it. So I have a few of these along the way as well. I was going to make a wife joke, and I thought, no, I'm not going to do that. I promised her I wouldn't do that. So, but other things that are out here are that you just kind of come across, these one-of-a-kind objects, where you find from the First World War especially, if soldiers were overseas somewhere, they probably had their army blanket embroidered with something. So I have a couple of these things, which are just amazing, amazing pieces. And I'm sure they're done in the Philippines or in China. That was a very common thing to be done. And of course, if you have your bicycle, you've got to have something on front to hold your flags, and you bolt that to the front of your bicycle handles, and there they go, they flutter in the wind. I mean, it's just wonderful stuff. I think there's $157 in this. It is all done with dollar bills sewn together, cut and sewn together. And this particular artist only works in dollar bills. Everything he does is with dollar bills in different configurations. For some reason, the feds haven't shot him down yet, but he does his wonderful pieces. And of course, Native Americans have incorporated the American flag for a long time. And I love the kind of advertising portion of this. It's just magical. There's, of course, in all the things that we collect, candy boxes and so on, these are just wonderful things. They used to be covered in silk and printed, and now they're paper or now they're plastic as they go forward. But they're pretty interesting pieces. And this piece was, from my understanding, as we all know, you don't always get wonderful provenance of everything you get. So you hear a story by someone who told it to you at the time, or from other people. And this, my understanding is, was done when the original cherry blossom trees were planted in Washington, that this was done as a gift from the Japanese to some official within Washington. So it's a wonderful hand-painted silk kimono. Now I have to be sure, because they're going to hold up signs at some point, but it means I have to get quicker, so I will try and be a little faster in doing this. This is from the Second World War. A quartermaster had taken envelopes and stamps from all people who had sent things to the troops. And all of the stars are made from the cancellations of capitals of the states in the order in which they were brought into the Union. How's that for you? Got nothing to do at night? Here's what you do. And then the 13 stripes are all mailed from the original 13 states. So it's a very interesting combination. And of course, I proudly bring this out, have a presentation in Kentucky, and a 9-year-old kid comes up and looks at it and finds the capital of Kentucky, and he says, "That isn't the capital of Kentucky." And I had Louisville, and it's Frankfurt. So thank you. But I didn't do it. It wasn't my fault. So I think it's interesting how the public engages itself in what you do in some cases. But it's a wonderful piece. And this is a salesman sampler that is used when in 48 states, 1912, the sampler was done, 13 different configurations of the stripes, stars and stripes. And of course, World War II, this was something that was done, this Give It Your Best, was a poster, was also poster stamps, and came in various sizes. And, you know, they end up, the government says, you know, you cannot put type on a flag and so on, but of course, they break their own rules when there's a particular need. And during the Second World War, they had bond raising events, and they would have these flags done. And this was actually from Pearl Harbor, and had actually been manufactured in Pearl Harbor. So it was an interesting piece. I'll have a lot of these kinds of things. So there's Civil War pieces, a lot of different individual infantry groups and so on would have flags done to celebrate their particular group. And for this is, again, a variation of the postal flag that you saw before, which has all of the states in it at that particular point. And this is maybe one of the most beautiful configurations of the stars. It's called the Whipple Peace Flag. It's done by Wayne Whipple. And that configuration of the stars is the center set of stars is the original 13 stars for the original colonies. Then the first row is the number of states that there were at that time, and that time being 1876. And then the stars after that were the ones that were added after that period of time. So there was room for additional stars even at that point. A beautiful thing, but he had been very much associated with the peace movement of the First World War, and it was never adopted. But a beautiful, beautiful format. This is from a GAR piece. They had so many conventions after the end of the war, and these symbols all around the edges are the individual battalions, and just represented each one of those. So the whole thing was there, pretty amazing. And then this is done by obviously an Allies flag at the end of the First World War. I don't need to explain the countries here, do we? No. Okay. And a good friend of mine is a photographer, and he's a big baseball fan. And the National Baseball League asked him to do something for the opening season, and he did this wonderful baseball flag. Of course, we always get associated with all kinds of other things. Battleship Maine, remember the Maine, and of course, it's toilet soap. I think that's quite wonderful. And advertising and the flag were so combined for so many years, we became the way in which things were done. And people thought, well, gee, if you're gonna buy Vaseline, you should buy American Vaseline because it's so much better. But it's so interesting how the flag and advertising are linked together. And that goes on, we are selling everything with the flag. And really until the kind of early quarter century of the 20th century did they say, it's not against the law, but it is not recommended to put type on a flag. But I love these things. They are just too magical for words. I know probably half of you out here have all these things, and I would love to tell you this is the original. There's only six in existence, whatever, they're worth over $100,000 each. This is a replica I bought for $10.95, but it's based on the original thing, and it was a real tin, printed tin flag. And of course, we also have old glory brands, so you'd put all kinds of fresh fruit and so on in there, and do it. And so, it made very strong presentations. Tobacco is a very big area. Tobacchiana is just such a strong area within American flags and such things, which goes to everything is in there, including cigar bands that are done with all the individual presidents. And they would be, you'd collect them. I mean, there are people out there besides us who collect this sort of stuff. So it's not only those of us who are professionals in the field. This is also, of course, Tobacchiana. I don't know how many of you have seen leathers before, but I have not seen that many of them, but I do have a few. But I didn't realize that outside of the felts and the flannels and the silks that they also had leathers. Of course, this is a silk cigarette card piece and a felt or flannel. And these come in all sizes, from 6 inches to 24 inches, and they're just people made them into quilts, into dresses, all kinds of things. And of course, we have our racist way as well as doing it within all the tobacco, cigar bands, cigar boxes. I'm not sure what that is. There we go. And I have to say one thing. My wife has said, this is not mine, this is hers. So she found this, and it's a wonderful piece. You could buy a little flagette for 10 cents. These, the Boy Scouts, they would talk to a flag company. They would send them a little box of 30 of these flags. They would sell them at 10 cents a piece. When they had $3, they could buy a 3 by 5 foot flag. And so it was a way of being able to interest people in getting engaged in it. And I think most of you may know that in 1942, in July 42, all publishers in America put a flag on the cover of their magazines, no matter what it was. Chicken Coop Monthly would have one on there. So it had a very broad range and appeal in here. So there are, I think, about 140 or so different covers that have been done. And of course, there was a wonderful thing done during the Kennedy administration. This is obviously before he was killed. But Henry Wolfe, one of the great American designers, created this for Show magazine. Civil War covers, very big area. Seems like hundreds and hundreds of them were done on both sides. It wasn't limited to the Union side at all, but there were some really quite wonderful things that were done. That, in fact, I will even use my pointer here. Does this work? There we go. Right there. That's when Lincoln was assassinated. They have, you know, the star has fallen. So they did so many special things for people along the way. Of course, again, commercial things, the Red Star Line, great fans. Fans are a wonderful area of ephemera. And whether it's a World War II, and these are triptychs that fold up, or this is another triptych with the old Pledge of Allegiance on it. Before we believed in God, we had this. Then we have the regular fans that you'd kind of get at a county fair. And this is a centennial one from Philadelphia in 1876. And this is a wonderful little piece. It's just little flags put together. Obviously not very practical, but effective. And these wonderful fold-up flags, these are very, very common in the kind of turn of the century. And these things, cigar flags, and Uncle Sam kind of finds his way because he also, you pull his head out and his and it comes out. These are pretty rare. I haven't seen, I have one, and I don't know if anybody else has one. I understand there is a Lady Liberty that does the same thing. So if you have one, you probably have a ready buyer here if you are interested in getting rid of it. Of course, we went through, and we're very big on flags and living flags. And so all over the country, you'd have just different communities get together, dress up for 4th of July or Flag Day or Memorial Day, and they were just done all over the country. Very interesting things in the way in which they're done. And of course, the kind of ultimate is done with Mole and Thomas, who were a photography team primarily during the First World War. And they would get up on scaffolds that were like 80 feet high, and they would, how they organized it, I don't know. But this is made of, I believe this is 15,000 soldiers put together. And at the bottom, there's only three guys at the bottom of there, and up in the little ball at the top, there's about 500 guys. So to work out all of the visuals of this from the point of view where they have, before you have Photoshop, before you do any of that stuff, these guys worked it out. And it's just amazing the kind of things they did. And this is 25,000 guys. I mean, I've been in the military. I know how easy it is to get people organized, but not like this. This is not the way it happens. It just blows me away. And there's, you know, they I'm sure that they did them, and then they sold them for a buck a piece to each one of these guys if they could. So they had a ready-made audience. But, you know, it's like, hey, Mom, I'm in the upper left-hand corner. See me? You know, I mean, it's pretty interesting stuff. And, of course, there are people, and I've done this talk for a few years, and I used to go out, I would give a little presentation and say, isn't it amazing this guy had a full bit of tattooing, and half the audience had the same bit of tattooing. So it isn't that fresh anymore. So Uncle Sam, and I will keep this going, Uncle Sam, as you may know, was an actual person, or at least based on an actual person, Samuel Wilson, 1813, he was a supplier of meat to the troops during the War of 1812, and so he used to put U.S. on the barrels of meat he would send, and that was, and it became one of those things. Uncle Sam's were how they called the meals, And it just became one of those myths that got created along the way. But of course, Uncle Sam is everywhere, so ubiquitous in our society and within all kinds of things that we do, every holiday, everything we're trying to sell to anyone else in the world, Uncle Sam was very happy to be the guy who presented it to you. So whether it was ham or it was thread, wheat, everything. Just amazing use of him in so many different places. And I love this World War II set of cards to where the Joker was Hitler and Mussolini at the bottom, but Uncle Sam and Lady Liberty and the sailors and soldiers were the jacks and queens and kings of that entire deck. And of course, there's these one-of-a-kind pieces that these all come out of China, and they're probably kind of turn of the century, first part of the 20th century. And they're all made of American stamps, all cut to be in these things. But of course, they're individually illustrated as well. So they're really quite wonderful in their artwork in putting them together. And of course, Uncle Sam can sell anything. And so whether he's selling tobacco or he's selling prophylactic toothbrushes there. So, and would you buy from that guy? I mean, he is so sleazy, I can just hardly stand it. And of course, if there's the opening of the Panama Canal, these cards, and this doesn't even work, but one of those cards has sand in it, and you pour it from one side to the other, showing that he's pouring or drinking from these, and the bear also. Happy Thanksgiving, everyone. And for my suffragette lady in here, hi. I just thought, isn't this a wonderful piece for this combination of Uncle Sam and drag? I mean, I think it's just absolutely great. Absolutely great. It says it's part of a series of six. And so maybe you have the other five, but it's the only one I've seen like this. Now, Lady Liberty is one of those things that originally was a Indian princess, and it was the kind of thing you would find early on in this in our country. And of course, as we began to get further and it was a much more European crowd, we became a little bit more Roman and Greek goddesses along the way. And then of course, then you get into the Statue of Liberty, which of course is completely made an American or a Northern European out of the person itself. But there, and that has become everything, whether it's a young girl or whether it's people who are just draped in the flag, Lady Liberty in one form or another exists out there and is just magical for me. I just love them. They come in there, obviously everybody knocks off everybody, so you have it in four color, then you'll have a two color version and a one color version, and it's amazing how things get turned around and reused by the same printers in some cases with different names at the bottom. This is a little paper doll thing where you can have the basic body and put different things on it. Again, we sell everything with Lady Liberty as well. And you know, here's the kind of same artwork, just kind of reworked for one for soap and one for champagne. This just goes on and on. Yeah, I'm sure you all have as many as I do, this vast array of the way in which Lady Liberty has been interpreted. And of course, First World War had some wonderful things. Leindecker did these wonderful posters for the Boy Scouts to raise money for war bonds. And this was one I found, it could have even been at this particular space a few years ago. And I thought, oh, isn't that kind of so sweet? And there's this American flag and this woman, isn't that great? And then I found that she kind of got around the world a little bit. And same woman in so many different flags. If anybody has any different flags than I have, I'd be happy to add them to the collection. But there's just, every time I go somewhere, I'll find a new one. And of course, they're oftentimes draped as costumes for various events. 4th of July was a much bigger thing earlier part of the last century. And so you've got some really magical ways in which people put things together. And this figure in the middle, that has the flags on it, just basically unprinted, uncut flags. You could buy bolts of material that were flags and just hadn't been cut. This is a more contemporary version of that. So again, a photographer friend of mine had done this. So I have a pretty broad range of things that I collect. How am I doing on time?
22 minutes left.
Oh my God. Okay, I'm fine. We get into politics, and again, as Bruce was saying earlier on, the flag and everything to do with anything is about America gets wrapped into our politics. And so whether it's buttons, of which we have, I have a few hundred, but many of you may have many more, but I find them just fascinating how they get used, the materials that are used, whether they're celluloid or they're printed tin or plastic or early pieces of lead, which some of them were from, so it's pretty interesting stuff. Benjamin Harrison, one of the all-time pamphleteers. He really knew how to promote with all kinds of materials, and he did all kinds of great things with handkerchiefs, bandanas, bits of cloth in any way. He seemed to get a lot of that out there. So there he is again with another bandana. So he knew how to market with the flag. You're getting these wonderful printed tins that represent the history of whoever the candidate is. And Roosevelt, of course, had some wonderful things. Who is the politician who always had to have a drink of water? I apologize if I'm doing that today, but I'm sorry.
Rubio,
right. Yeah, see how he lasted. Okay, so these kinds of things, oftentimes you combine things with the American flag. Things get pasted on top of it. There was so much concern because of the Second World War that, gee, we're going to lose a president, and then there was the guys don't want to have another third-term president and so on. And so that was true at that particular time. And, of course, Teddy Roosevelt did some wonderful things. I'm not sure why I had this damaged card that I showed you, but anyway, it's quite a nice thing. And, of course, they used the same backgrounds for all kinds of, put another face on it, draw another face on it. So it was very, very common to see these kinds of things. And of course, I think kind of the classic thing is when William Jennings Bryan, he tried for three times to be president, and Taft always seemed to beat him, but they always went through and they would have these, the printers would go ahead and set these gold and red and blue printed cards, and then they would just imprint the face of whoever they were trying to promote at the time. So that kind of went on, and these were where they incorporated everything, the Eagles, flags, Uncle Sam, Lady Liberty, they all got in there, and they were beautifully done, beautifully crafted. Just went on and on. And there was oftentimes the same things, but they would just put different photographs in place along the way. Now, protest is something that I think is an integral part of who we are as a nation. And it's important, I think, that even though we may not always agree with protesters along the way, it's an important part of our democracy. This is my last statement for that area. But I think it's important that we celebrate that as well as we do the how wonderful we are in other ways. And so this particular piece that you're seeing now is from the Vietnam, anti-Vietnam, I won't call them riots, but demonstrations done in Berkeley, of course in Berkeley. With the rifles for the stripes and the airplanes for the stars. Very simple, very effective piece. And this by a friend of ours, Seymour Quast, again, anti-Vietnam piece, really quite a powerful piece. And I love the juxtaposition of these two particular pieces. One, obviously, a World War I James Montgomery flag poster, and I actually don't know who designed the I Want Out one, but a very interesting combination of them. Of course, all kinds of peace symbols in the corporation of the peace symbol and the flag are also another strong protest piece. And the other way as well, MIA, how many soldiers were left over in Vietnam? So there's, it's the flag gets used in all of these ways. And of course, if you want to keep someone out of war, keep us neutral, whatever, there was whole movements of that, as I'm sure many of you know. This is the Bush AIDS flag, and you'll see a variation of that a little later on. When I was in Germany, I was working in Germany for a year, when the American troops were still a very strong thing there, and you would buy these doormats so people would wipe their feet on the flag when they went in. Now you can get them at Orchard Hardware, and it's like a celebration of the American flag. So it's interesting how things change, but it is originally a protest piece in having it there for people to wipe their feet on. And this is done by your next speaker. Marty Peterson did this. He and I, all disclosures, he and I used to be partners. And we're still friends, in fact, very good friends, maybe even better friends. But he is a fabulous designer and had done some wonderful things, and this is one of the pieces that I was just most influenced by in showing the diminishment, if that is a word, of the Native American within this country. And it kind of follows from the very early days down to where there's almost no involvement whatsoever. And it was an interesting kind of protest piece. Marty, are you going to show this piece as well? No, okay. And of course, it doesn't really matter what particular stripe you are within politics. You can always use the American flag, or in this case, the cross, as a way of promoting one thing or another. This is for prohibition. And it was a very, very strong movement, and this combination of the religious side and the American side, flag side, was a powerful image. And in talking about the Bush AIDS flag before, this was done by John Lennon and Yoko Ono. And this is a piece that was done just talking about how many people have been killed through various wars in various groups, and of course the United States is one of those groups along the way. And this is actually the last piece in this little presentation. We have some time to be able to chat, I hope, afterwards. As all of us, we are all moved by 9/11 and the impact that it had on our culture. And this was a piece that I had done just to celebrate the first responders to that. And so I do sell it to raise money for first responders and still continue to do so. And it's something that I had specially done for that because it was something that meant so much to me. And this was done on the 10th anniversary of the event. And so I thought it was an interesting kind of celebration and protest piece at the same time. So I think I will turn this over to you guys to chat a little bit with me, I hope, along the way. Have I been much too efficient? Now, this is one of those crowds that nobody wants to ask any questions, is it? Ah, right up. They're shills. We brought them in for this purpose alone, yes.
This is graphic. And of course, there are all kinds of other ways of referring to the flag. Has your obsession fitted into music? That is the audio realm, for example, or have you found other?
Well, because I'm a graphic designer and I'm more interested in the visual than I have in other things, but I don't collect patriotic songs per se, although I use it in doing some videos and so on. I will certainly do that. Ray Charles does a great America that's stunning, but I have not collected in that particular area, but I have lots of music sheets and covers of music sheets, so that's been about as far as it's gone in the audio file. Sir. Hi, Art.
What percentage of material in your collection would you say was created overseas?
Did you all hear the question? Okay. What percentage of the collection was created overseas? Certainly in the last 20 years, most of it, probably, although I don't...
I didn't mean produce, but, you know, sell products.
Oh.
That sort of thing.
Oh, well, there's certainly... we've been very good at marketing as a country, and so the idea that we use the flag or American-made products as something of quality, that was a very important part of it, and a good portion of all of that kind of ephemera would have been made for that audience. But now, of course, a lot of the things are made overseas to sell to us, which I find an interesting kind of ironic thing to happen. Yes. Yes, sir.
The symbol of the flag is a very sensitive issue for most Americans.
Mm-hmm.
Where would you draw the line between something that's just schmaltz or kitsch and something that's disrespectful?
It's a pretty thin line, isn't it? I think most of you know the appropriate way to dispose of a flag once it is worn is to burn it. I think that's a relatively common bit of knowledge out there. And at the same time, although I'm very much in favor of the appropriate respect for the flag and the way in which it's done and used, I also respect the ability to make it a political symbol and to burn it in protest. I think that's part of what makes us who we are. I have more disrespect for the used car salesman who uses it at the Washington's birthday car sales that just drives me nuts. But I suppose if I was a collector of French Impressionist paintings and I saw another fabulous painting that was done and turned into a tie or a magnet to go in a refrigerator, I would be as upset with that. I just think there's a lot of terrible trivialization of the flag and the way in which it's oftentimes used and overused, really. I think there's really two categories in that, but that's my opinion on that. Yes. I bet. I do have Uncle Sam nutcrackers too, as well. But in three-dimensional area, I have a lot of ice cream and chocolate molds that are for the flag and Uncle Sam. So that's not an uncommon kind of configuration of the flag in some way. I love those things. They're just great. Yes. Well, there may be someone here who's more of an authority on that. I'm sorry. Where does the origin of Doughboy come from? Oh, that's a First World War soldier that came over to Europe to fight. That was a Doughboy. And you know.
I know something. They made their bread out of their hats, their helmets.
Oh, well, there's something that I did not know before. That's great. But I know the term, but I don't know how good the bread was, but... wonderful. Well, this has been an event in itself, just learning that information. That is great. That is great. Yes, in the back. I just have lots of duplicates. we Well, we actually have cataloged everything. Although most of it's in binders, I don't type it in and it immediately comes up, and I know that. And also, of course, when I come to something like this, I see something, God, that's wonderful. I don't think I have that. But when you have 4,000, 5,000, 8,000 pieces, you don't remember them all. But I certainly the things that really mean a lot to me, the one-of-a-kinds, are truly one-of-a-kind. But when you get into postcards and so on, it's I have too many duplicates. It's a little scary. Yes, miss?
I'm assuming that your collection is still in private hands. Do you have plans for where it will eventually become?
Well, that was very nicely put. I didn't ask her to do this, but I actually have created a Stars and Stripes Foundation. So I do have a foundation which eventually will own all of the pieces that I have. They'll be part of that. And it's primarily for educational purposes. We promote things. We try and give information about things. So if anyone wants to know any more about this, we'd be open to donations, by the way. If anyone wants to add any money to it, it would be just fine. Yes? Yes.
What does it
mean? It's just a paper flag.
So
it's just a paper poster, yeah.
And what about your 9/11? That,
that's all right. It is a silkscreen serigraph poster. Okay. And so it's about 36 inches high. Okay. In the back, Julie. Yes. I know. Julie, it's very nice of you to get it for me, so thank you. But I think one of the things that is so wonderful about what we do in collecting this stuff is you love the hunt of it. And it's not only going out and saying, well, we know there's 100 of these, and I've got 98, I'm looking for the last two. It's the ones you don't know about that, to me, have some of the most interest. To me, and I won't do too much soapbox here, but I think that our flag, which is, I think most of you know the history of it, but 1777, you know, a paragraph, alternating red and white stripes with a blue field and white stars to represent a new constellation. That's the guidelines of the flag of our country. And until 1818, when we started to start adding more stripes and stars at the same time, we put an end to that, being a very practical people, and said, no, we're going back to 13 stripes, and then we'll just change the stars on July 4th of the following year. And that has been it forever. And yes, in 1912, when we got 48 states, we formalized it much more. But we've been something, the flag has been something that has been something created by the people of this country. And to me, the spirit of the people of this country come through in the variations, the folk art aspect of how they put stars together, how these things start to just, the proportions of them, the exact colors of them. It's great to see it just created by the individuals in this country. And so I love the aspect of finding the one of a kinds. The woman who sewed it during the Civil War, had it on a quilt and turned it over on one side when the Confederacy was in town and turned it back over with a flag on it the other side. So there's that kind of thing. It's something that is of the spirit of the people, and it's there, and I think that's inherent in this symbol. So, yes, okay. Does that answer it, Julie? No, I have no answer, but I'd like whatever you've got. Right, okay. Yes. I do, but I mean, there's 27 official flags, but there are all kinds of variations of the stars. Until 1912, there was no formal way in which it was to be done. And so you get the Great Star Flag, which are some wonderful things from the Civil War. But almost any way people wanted to put stars on the flag was the way it was. And so I know what they are. I know an example of each one of them, but I certainly don't have all of them. And my collection really is from a little bit before the Civil War, but not much until today. Did that answer your question, George?
Yeah.
Sort of? Okay. Yes. Miss Suffragette. Well, you obviously read the book. That's good. I only wish that I had. The origins of the flag at that particular moment. We're in the first year of our Revolutionary War. On the same day, in June 4th, 1777, John Paul Jones got his commission to be a captain of a ship. Interesting things happened on that day. But there was a request by Native Americans who were working with the American troops and wanted to find a way to be able to basically get safe passage to go and to go through the lines. And so that was part of the reason of having a flag that was identified throughout the country as much as it could be at that point, and the idea of having a flag that we had very practical reason for the Native Americans as well. Yes, sir.
Yeah, two questions. I mean, same theme on your foundation.
Yeah.
Does it operate from a physical location, more or less like a library, and is it primarily self-funded? I think a lot of people are interested in such questions.
Of course.
And would like to know their own place.
Yeah. It is a 501c3. It's an official, not a tax dodge, but it is a taxable organization or a non-taxable organization that allows people to donate to it. And as long as it has an educational bed to it, we have a website which was still being built, of course. But we're doing all those things, and we have exhibitions around the country. There's one in Pennsylvania, for those of you who are there, in July at the Mercer Museum in Pennsylvania. We'll have an exhibition there from July 2nd to November 6th. I can have all the exhibitions I want as long as they start on July 4th and go through as many holidays as you can during that period of time. But it is, right now, it is my office and my home. That's where it is.
And you're the staff.
And, we have a board of directors of about 15 people who are engaged in this. And they're collectors, they're experts in it, they are communicators, they are presidents of universities, whatever, who are all part of it. And, it's pretty much self-funded. We've gotten some grants from people along the way. We get paid for the exhibitions that we have out there. So it's not at all uncommon for you to do it. It took us about a year and a half to be able to get the certification, but we did go through the process. Yes, sir.
How hard is it to get 49?
Actually, it is pretty rare. It was only 1 year, and although it was common in a way because it's relatively current, but you'll have a hard time finding them. They're not that easy. I have some, but you can usually get them with the flagpole attached. You get the whole bit, usually in little packets, got everything in it. A couple of small versions. They kind of came as a little kit. Yes.
What's the biggest drag that's ever made, and do you know where it is?
That distinction seems to vary depending on who's making by that time. I have seen them, 100 yards wide that they hang from the side of a building, and it's like whatever football field you want to have one in. There are very large ones that are out there. I couldn't give you an actual dimension, but if you ever watch a football game. We bring them out every football game, it seems like. Troops bring them out, wave them, and then they fold them back up and put them away. But those are only for that display. Those are primarily for buildings and for ships, which was the main designation from the beginning. Yes, miss?
You mentioned how sentimental we are. I was in Baltimore visiting Fort Henry.
Yes.
It is. Because they use all the guests
Oh, that's great. I was there in 2014 for the 200th anniversary, and it's an emotional experience. I agree. You know, a lot of the ways in which we kind of love the flag and have this image of the flag is something that's been created in the last 100 years. The first time around, I mean, every time I see a Revolutionary War film where they've got someone charging up the hill with their 13-star Betsy Ross flag, we know that, afraid, that isn't the case. It just didn't happen. There were very few flags out there. Most of them were on ships or buildings. And it wasn't until really the Civil War that we had any kind of configuration at all with a number of them along the way. Am I down to my 1 minute yet?
No.
Oh, my God. So you guys have to keep talking because I'm supposed to be here. Yes. That's a great story. That is a great story. Thank you for telling me that. If I can give you one more in that, not the same category, but I had a fellow who was, he was probably about 85, and he was beginning to say, I have to get rid of things. I just don't have stuff around. And he had seen that I was a flag collector, and he came and brought a picture, a photograph from World War II of his sister, and she was wearing, she had won a baton twirling contest in the state, and she was going to go on to the nationals. And she had this special outfit made, which was an American flag. And she, with all the strength and glory in her in doing it, was going to do it, and she was disqualified because she had a flag on her dress. And I thought, how can that happen? How can we not embrace the spirit of people who do that and enjoy it and bring it in the best way and just say, oh, well, that's disrespecting the flag because it was made into a dress. It broke my heart. And he was talking about how it kind of destroyed his sister, how she was really kind of crushed at that moment by doing so. Anyway, yes.
Everywhere.
Yeah, it's not, we're a very flag-waving population here, I can tell you. We do love it, maybe too much, but it is very common here, and I've had some British friends who've said the same thing. So it's been interesting. Yes, sir. You're absolutely right. I mean, it's so ubiquitous. And when I used to collect everything that was kind of graphically interesting, as many graphic designers do. And then my wife has said, well, why don't you focus this attention? You have, you know, you have this wonderful this flag that's a family heirloom. Why don't you focus on the flag? And, of course, once you start that, and you then you see it everywhere. And you begin collecting it, and there's not a limit of, well, I find certain thing. You find it everywhere, everywhere. I cannot walk into any shop at some point, doesn't have a flag on it, whether it's made in the USA in the label of a shirt or an historic cup or something. It's just phenomenal. So I know that my time is probably at the end here. Oh, you've got one more question back here. Yes, sir. I mean, besides flag obsessionists, that thing? Well, the collecting of flags, as you probably all know, vexillology is the category, vexillology, and a vexillologist is one who studies flags. And it's a relatively new, well, it's probably 20, 30 years old, maybe more, but it's an actual term. I thought you guys all knew that sort of thing. Well, there we go. It's been your day, too. Okay, all right. Oh, V-E-L, Vex, no, V-E-X, right, O-L, I, good, I-L, O-G-Y, okay, fine, vexillologist, yes, right, did you Google that, or did you actually know it? okay, fine. Absolutely right. He's got that little flag show he does, isn't it? Yeah, absolutely. Well, listen, it has been a real joy. I'm so happy to be here, and I am going to enjoy the next few days of poking around with you guys. So thanks very much.